Hi, folks. I'm Ivan Krugov. I'm very glad to see all of you here. That's probably my biggest audience, which I have so far. So yeah, and I'm here to talk about the service mesh, which we introduced at booking.com, and we base it on Envoy. So let me, to begin with, let me briefly touch on where I'm from. I'm from booking.com. We base in Amsterdam. We actually sell stays in hotels, villas, rooms, apartments, whatever, and we actually sell quite a lot of them, up to 1.5 million stays, room nights per day. And we're actually quite a big IT company, so we almost touching 2,000 people in IT. So, and this talk is going to be following this agenda. So first of all, I want to really briefly talk about what the service mesh is. I think there is a lot of interest in this topic, and I'm not sure that the service mesh term is properly settled yet. So I just want to explain what I mean when I say service mesh. We're going to talk about why we started the project, what was the objectives there. We're going to talk about our setup. This is where we spend the majority of the presentation, going deep, quite deep there. We'll learn. I'll explain the learnings which we've got on our path during the service mesh, and in the end, just a couple of the summary words. Okay, so without any further ado, let me talk very briefly about what the service mesh is. And you see there is a little star here. So by doing this, I just want to say, like, this is how I understand things, right? It's not necessary. Like, if you ask somebody else in the audience, they might give a different opinion. So let's consider this hypothetical service, and we have the service provider and the service consumer, right? So consumer consume the service. And in the pre-service mesh era, they managed to communicate somehow. Well, it doesn't matter how, but they managed to communicate. With the service mesh, we actually introducing this communication infrastructure, right? So we outsource this facilities to the infrastructure layer, which is now responsible to finding out who to talk to, authorizing, monitoring, like all of those things, right? And here we can maybe even talk about kind of communication as a service, right? So this is kind of, we have a code which sits here, and we have a facilities which this service used to talk to some other service, right? And this is actually, nowadays, the usual implementation of this infrastructure layer is that we have a proxies. Like, those proxies sit next to both the consumer and the provider, and the application code speak to them, and the proxies somehow talk to, with each other. So this is the service mesh, and on top of that, we have a control plane. The key property of these proxies is that they actually dynamically configured. Right, so we have a control plane layer, which is now dictate the rules of the game. It says, like, okay, proxy, this is how you handle the traffic. And this is proxy, hey, like, this is how you do the retry. So yes, the control plane, this is the orchestrator, which tells the proxies how to behave. So, and this is what I will, this is what I will mean when I will say service mesh during my presentation. So, why we actually started this service mesh project? And to answer to this question, I actually need to give you a little bit of history inside the booking.com. Booking.com has traditionally been a big, gigantic monolith written in Perl. We have quite a lot of code sitting there. And what we're currently doing, we're trying to split this big monolith into multiple services. So we're moving toward the service-oriented architecture, right? And the way we currently imagine this is that this broke up will be done in the two technological stacks. This is, we imagine this to be Perl and Java, and here I just use the two colors just to represent these two technology stacks, right? But at the same time, what we envision that in future, like as the SOA move forward, we will have more and more demand for the stacks to be different, right? So instead of having our architecture to be painted in two colors, now we have multiple colors. Or maybe I should put it a little bit differently and say that I think this is quite a wise idea to build your infrastructure in a way which will give a business flexibility to accommodate any technological stack if it needs, right? So I really want to build an infra where I can say to the business, hey guys, like, if you need a Python in your stack, fine, we're ready to accommodate it. If you need a Java, cool. If you need a Node.js, also fine. So Yes. So basically, having this variety and diversity, potential diversity of the technology being involved into Booking.com, we really want to achieve these two key properties, right? We really want to make sure that it doesn't. We really want to make sure to have a state where it doesn't matter what tech stack services implemented it. We can wrap it with a set of tools, practices, and technologies to be able to deliver the consistent behavior of the communication between the services, right? So like we know that it doesn't matter that the service A is in the Perl and the service B is in the Java or in the Python, whatever. They always communicate in the same way. And here the consistency also comes in terms of kind of outages, really the edge cases, right? So we really want to make sure this happens at the same time. And the second objective is the visibility, right? We really want to make sure that it doesn't matter where the communication comes from, either it's a major service or just a curl running in a bash script. We really have a very good understanding of what's going on there. So we have things under control, visible, observable, so we know that what's the response codes, et cetera. Okay, so this is the main objectives. Once again, the consistency and the visibility in the communication. Let's go into our setup, right? So what's going on there? So let's come back to this example, which I already used, where we have the consumer and the provider. What we currently decided to do, where we started from, is that we thought that deploying the proxies only on the consumer side is already gives us a lot of advantages on its own. So we want to make sure that we do deployment of the service mesh step by step. So instead of trying to deploy this kind of big, gigantic thing at the same time, we want to say, okay, we start with the proxies on the consumer side, and somewhere later we will also deploy them on the provider side. And to speak with, only having the proxies on the client side already gives us a lot of benefit, because this is the client side point of view. This is the client experience. So for example, if we measure the latency inside the proxy next to the client, we'll be as close to the user experience as possible, right? So yes, we have this proxy, and this is our data plane. And what's going to happen within the next 10 or 15 minutes or so, I'm going to expand this diagram, and I'm going to do multiple zoom-ins into multiple components to show you like what is going on there. And the first such a zoom-in is that I would like to explain what we use as a proxy. So when we started the service mesh implementation, we considered these two options, we weighted them, Linkerd and Envoy, which were available on the market. I think nowadays there are more choices. But we actually favored Envoy for two reasons. And the first reason was that Envoy provided us a feature of the graceful restart. Why this is quite important for us, because we actually deployed on the bare metal mostly. So Booking.com, together with transition from SOA to Monolith, we also transitioned from the bare metal setup into the cloud native setup. But we started from the bare metal. So, and having the graceful restart on the bare metal, when the proxy restarts, we don't drop connections. That was a must-have feature for us. And the second one was that the Envoy in its roots is really a TCP proxy, which means that the potential deployment of Envoy is not limited to the HTTP communication, but rather any communication. For example, right now there are filters available for Envoy. Filters is basically plugins, which can understand Redis, which can understand CouchDB. Right now they're actually thinking about having a Kafka support there. So this is not necessarily what we currently using, but this has greatly expanded the potential scope of Envoy. So yes, we chose Envoy and we decided to move forward with it. So yeah, now the next thing is, so we have Envoy on the client side, and we need to have a control plane which will dictate the rules of the game. So basically, what's the routing policy, what's the service discovery, what's the failure budget, how to retry, etc. Let's do a bit of zoom in there, because there are some quite interesting bits, in my opinion. So first of all, we decided to move forward with in-house control plane. And we originally built it using version 1 API of Envoy, and later migrated to the version 2. There might be a question like, why in-house? Why not things like Istio, which is you probably all heard about? Well, the reason here is very simple. We started in August 2017. Istio was, I think, only a couple of months before released and announced, and it was a version around like a 0.1 or 0.2, I don't remember exactly. So it was a very early phases of the Istio. And another reason I really want to follow this principle of having a small step at a time, at a time. So we first want to gain operational knowledge of the Envoy itself, of the data plane, right? And then trying to introduce the next more complicated thing, such as Istio, because there is quite a lot of complexity there. So yes, those are two reasons. And another thing which is quite important, which I already touched, is that we knew that in the initial phases, our majority of the customers will be on a bare metal setup in the traditional booking stack. And the Istio was, and to great extent still is, mostly oriented toward Kubernetes, which for us was not really a good fit. The second, another thing which we made a very conscious decision while building our control plane is that we didn't want to introduce our own DSL, which will now abstract people away from the Envoy configuration. So yes, really what we did, we just say, okay, guys, okay, whoever is going to operate the service mesh and the configure the settings for the particular service, they will need to just learn a bit of the Envoy, of Envoy configuration. We will, I'll expand a little bit more about this in my later slide. For now, just take this in mind. And what we also understood is that the variety of features which Envoy gave us at that time, it was version 1.4, was already quite enough. So we really didn't want to strive for the features. We just said, this is good enough. We just want to have it implemented and deploy at booking.com. And another quite important feature is that we want to give end users, we call them service owners, the power to configure the service mesh, which is responsible for communication in their services. So we want to have a self-service service for them to provide such. Okay, so this is the principle behind the control plane. And in practice, control plane is actually quite like in our implementation, control plane is implemented in Go, it's a couple of thousand lines of code. And one of the things which it does, it provides the gluing layer between the service discovery, which is, so we have an in-house service discovery at Booking based on the Zookeeper, and we also needed to provide one from the Kubernetes. So speaking about this service discovery integration is really a little bit outside of this talk, so I don't want to touch it. But rather, I want to talk about a little bit more interesting topics, such as how we actually provide configuration to the service mesh. Which is then, so how we provide configuration to the control plane, which then push configuration to the invoice. So yes, zooming in inside the Zookeeper configuration, which is stored in Zookeeper. So when we started working, if you right now go to invoice site and try to open documentation, what you will find is that there is a huge amount of things which can be configured there. This is just one of the properties of Envoy. This is that it is dynamically configured. So the configuration there are quite rich, and documentation so as well. So and we want to, like as I said before, we wanted to give people this self-service, so the power to configure configure setting themselves. But at the same time, we didn't want to give them too much, right? Because if this is too much, they will say, okay, sorry, dude, like this is too complicated, I'm not going to look inside. This is why we basically traded these two options of giving people enough power so they can do things themselves, but also trading the usability so we don't overload people too much with the variety of options which Envoy provides us. This is why what we find out is that out of the entire Envoy configuration, people usually need to configure these two pieces. First of them is the cluster specification in terms of Envoy, and another one, cluster specification defines this is the group of machines and this is the act as a single unit. And the second part of the configuration is a virtual host. This is the routing rules, which says that if you saw this, this request going to this domain, please route it to that particular cluster. So yes, those are two things which we extracted from the Envoy configuration, say, okay, this is what we're going to provide to the end users, and the rest things they will not touch. This is how the configuration looked like. This is might be quite scary for you at this moment, but don't worry, it's actually not that complex, and I'm going to walk you through. So at the very top, oh, and by the way, here, we actually like Kubernetes and we like its data model. So we decided to use these Kubernetes objects. So this thing looks like a Kubernetes object, but they're actually not inside the Kubernetes. We just use the structure to represent configuration. So at the very top, as already mentioned, we have a cluster specification and we have a virtual host specification, right? Those specifications might have annotations might have metadata, which basically link the control plane and the Voi with the booking ecosystem, right? For example, right now, which is highlighted is that this is the integration with the service discovery mechanism. The rest of the specification, this is basically literally the plane cluster and a virtual host in Voi configuration. So like you can go to the Google you can go to Envoy documentation and just Google it. Like we don't have any modifications there, it's a straightforward. And this is the trade-off, how we say that, okay guys, we're going to provide you full full power to configure the clusters and the virtual host the way you want, but we also abstract you a little bit away from doing like all the things at the same time. And even with this amount of, by the way, this is the default configuration which we recommend. And even, but even with this amount of small things, this actually for the newbie, this is kind of, this is, might be, again, considered to be too much. This is why we wrote a simple kind of script which actually do a bootstrap. So it basically walk you through the process saying like, hey, like what's your service name, what's your clients, where it's deployed. So kind of this whole simple question and simply bootstrap things for you, providing configuration out of the box. Okay. That's all about configuration. Well, that's almost all about configuration. Let's look inside how we actually store things in Zookeeper. How we store things in the Zookeeper. So let's imagine here C stands for the cluster spec and the V stands for the virtual host spec. Let's imagine that we have a service A. And one thing which I forgot to mention is that on top of this cluster specification and virtual host specification, we have a very tiny layer which now says who this service should be exposed to. You will understand it in the next couple of seconds. So let's say that we have a service A which says that I want to be exposed to the service B. So for example, your API want to be available for the search engine or the other way around. Then we also have a service B which says I don't want to be exposed to anybody. And we have a service C which is exposed also to the service D. All of this information got propagated to the control plane. Control plane simply watched this configuration in the Zookeeper. And then when an Envoy comes, it says, okay, dude, I'm a service D, and now control plane knows what kind of configuration it should be propagating to that particular Envoy. So we use this node object inside the Envoy request. So yes, Envoy comes, says I'm a service D, and the control plane reply to it, hey, I'm actually, here's the service A and the service C specification. So like this way, we limit the scope of the availability of particular services. Okay, this is almost all about configuration, but the configuration is not static, right? So we need to periodically update it. So there is a process which is how we introduce configuration changes, right? And let's do a little bit of zoom in there. So deployment changes, we decided to move forward with the approach where at booking.com we use this open source tool which we also created called git deploy to deploy changes. And we simply decided to we simply said that the configuration changes is undistinguishable from the code changes, right? So basically, the configuration changes is just there is a Git repository where you have your settings, and we have a standard way at booking.com to deploying them to the production. And of course, when we're doing so, we don't go in full in, right? So we do what we called Vanguard. At Booking, it's called Vanguard. And the rest of the industry knows it as a canary, right? So we first deploy to 10% of machines, then we gradually increase this percentage to make sure that things move forward smoothly. And of course, like given this full power to configure things to the end users, we also do a bit of validation, right? So first of all, the deployment process, make sure that the syntax is correct, but also do a little bit of semantic validation, right? So for example, like one of the checks which we're doing is that a particular deployment doesn't steal the traffic from another one. So for example, if I know that I have a search service and I'm from different service, but I declare that I want to get the traffic from the search service, so we don't allow those kind of things. And at the very end, speaking about deployments, is that like every time we do deployments, we make sure that a part of the fast moving forward, we also have a fast rollback to make sure that if something goes wrong, we can quickly abort things and come back to the safe state. Okay, so on this diagram, we almost complete. There is a one last bit thing which is missing here, is that the visibility, the observations. Let's go there and check out what we are doing there. So we actually did two approaches there. The approach number one, we tried to send metrics from Envoy to Graphite using DiamondD. At Booking, we have a quite excellent in-house Graphite facility. So for us, it was a reasonable option. But what we quite quickly discovered, like as the service mesh got expanded, is that the amount of metrics which Envoy populate, I think Envoy populate about 100 metrics per single cluster, right? And this is multiplied by the amount of deployments. So in Graphite, the aggregations over the multiple instances quickly become unmanageable. So we decided to bail out to the approach number two with the Prometheus, which is nowadays is quite popular. And the way we use it, we simply leverage the StatsD support of Envoy and also StatsD exporter. So it basically multiple Envoy configured to send data over the UDP StatsD protocol to the StatsD exporter, and then the Prometheus scrape this information, giving us visibility over all the communication. And this is so we still not fully set there with this setup because, for example, right now there is no redundancy. So like if you guys have a good ideas of or you have a working solution of how we can make this, that will be like I would like to have a chat with you basically. And so basically what whole this story of the monitoring gives us the standard dashboard for any kind of services and communication which is currently in the service mesh. This is how it looks like. It's to a great extent it's borrowed from the Lyft. Thank you Matt for sharing your post of how you're doing the visibility. So it's basically kind of RPC cluster membership and those kind of things. And you can select, so like a two service, you can select like a which service you want to talk to. Okay, so this is almost, so basically, yes, this is the full picture. I'm done with explaining our setup. And I want to start sharing some of the learnings from the production usage, which we actually find out. So, and to give you an impression what our current scale is, so we're about 6 months, half a year in the production. So we started in August, we put it on in live about November. So we already migrated about 30 projects, which covered like 10,000 servers, roughly speaking, and all of them together doing hundreds of thousands of RPS per second. And one of the thing about the proxy is about Envoy is actually this is a layer 7 proxy. So that actually does a full HTTP, or full parse of HTTP protocol, which of course includes the overheads. And I want to share with you what's the overhead which we see in a production. And I want to share it with you, showing you this graph and the next one. So this is the HTTP perceived latency. Perceived latency means that it's measured on the client side, right? And here we see five percentiles from 50, 75, 19, 99. And this is the moment where we actually enabled experiment, putting Envoy right in the middle of the communication between the consumer and the provider. And as you can see, there is not a lot of increase. So we actually, what we see is about 1 millisecond of increase in the higher percentiles. So which is absolutely acceptable for us. So in our environment, the majority of the things takes about like a tenth of hundreds of milliseconds. So we won't be able to see this 1 millisecond increase. This is about HTTP. Speaking about HTTPS, I think a little bit more interesting. So the same graph, same P50, 75, 90, 95, and 99 percentiles. This is the moment where we enable the feature. So you see there is quite a significant growth in the latencies, but it's actually expected. Why this is expected? Because this is HTTPS. So Envoy established a pool of TLS sessions. And this is where it stopped doing this. So this is the moment of time where it says, okay, like I established enough TLS session, which takes time. And if you look at these timings, this is, again, roughly speaking, 1 millisecond of added latency, which we see in the up to 95 percentile. 99 is a little bit more interesting because, for example, there is in the top right, there is this spike, which is a little bit higher than 1 millisecond. Probably it's around like a 5 or 10 milliseconds, but this is still acceptable for us, taking into account all the benefits which Envoy and the service mesh gives us in terms of visibility, observability, control, consistency, etc. Okay, so yes, roughly speaking, plus 1 millisecond of latency per hop, this is good enough. Let's go to some findings, what we actually find there. So this is quite funny because we actually favored Envoy over Linkerd because of its ability to do graceful restarts. What we actually find out is that yes, graceful restart works, but they don't work always. And the moment where they don't work is that when Envoy got some major upgrades. So the way Envoy does a graceful restart is spawns two instances, and then those two instances start to negotiate with each other who is the current kind of leader. Right, and they do it over the protocol through the Unix socket. And when this protocol changes, this usually happens during the major upgrades. Like this graceful handover is not possible. This is where Envoy breaks. So for example, we face this upgrading from 1.4 to 1.5, I believe. So this is just for you. We still believe that so in the 99% of the cases where we need to restart Envoy, it never drops a connection. But those kind of cases where we do a major upgrade, which doesn't happen often, Envoy doesn't do this. The second thing which we observe is that if you guys are familiar with this X-Envoy retry on retry policy, there are three available options. Right now it's a little bit more, but when we started there was three available options. And one of them was a connect ferry. This is basically it tells Envoy to retry whenever there is a connection error. What we find out, this is actually, in a lot of the cases, this is too few, because this is like doesn't take into account any potential errors on the server side, any kind of 500 responses. The opposite of this, not really opposite, but the alternative for this option is the 5xx, which is instruct Envoy to retry any kind of 500 responses, 500, 501, 502, 503, basically all of them. But for now, this is often too much. Why? Because, well, we often have a non-idempotent request which are not safe to retry. This is why we propose this this feature, which has got accepted, such as the retry policy gateway error, which only retry 502, 503, 504, which is usually the error happens somewhere in the gateway, right? So, and this is what we currently use as a default. Another issue which we faced with Envoy is that we actually had several kernel panics because we experimented with a modern kernel for 14. And what we find out is that Envoy doesn't currently set the TCP keep alive flag on the TCP connection. This is how we end up with the multiple stale connections. This, but likely, just preparing to the presentation, I already noticed that, first of all, this is already fixed bug, so this is fixed feature, or I don't know how to name it. But basically, this feature coming in 1.7, and we temporarily work around it in 1.6 by having the idle timeout sent in the TCP mode. We just say, like, if there are no communication in this connection, just drop the connections. And my favorite one, we actually currently blocked on the upgrading from 1.5 to 1.6 because there was a rename of the cluster name to the cluster names. So yes, this is like if you're currently running with 1.5, just keep this in mind because, well, for us to work around this problem, this is quite a lot of work. Yes, so yeah, I think this is all, and I have 2 minutes left, and this is right on time to speak about conclusions. I actually spent quite a lot of time thinking about, hey, like, what should I say in the end? Because, like, overall, we're very positive about Envoy. We're very positive about the service mesh with our experience. We see a lot of benefits. We see great increase in the reliability property of our system. We see a great improvement in visibility because right now we can have the, we really observe and we found some cool things there. Which were not really visible before. But then I decided basically to boil down all my conclusion to this single statement, which I really believe in. So I think that on the path toward the SOA, service mesh is one of the building blocks which facilitated transition both technically by providing these reliability properties of the communication, but also which is interesting from the organization point of view, organizational point of view. Why? Because it helps you facilitate the ownership of the services. Like this is a common problem, at least this is what we see a lot, is that in a model, when we break a monolith into service-oriented architecture, people don't really used to having ownership, right? And And the service mesh, by providing features, by providing tools, which is available, which is smart enough, it really make people use the things in the right way. Okay, so, oh yes, and this is, like a, once again, like a start, this is the way I understand things. At the very end, I want to point it out to my colleague's talk, Andrei Vereha. He will share more of the funny stories which we experienced during the introduction of the Envoy and operational experience. So yes, check it out. And I am done. Thank you very much.